It's my great pleasure and of course honor to be kind of first speaker in this forum, looking at the digitalization in forestry. My name is Petteri Pihlajamaki. I come from Pöyry Management Consulting. I have been heading our global forestry consulting services for a long time and working with our clients, which are mostly forest industry companies in fiber strategies and forestry strategies and everything that relates to developing sustainable forest operations. So it's my great pleasure to kind of share some reflections related to the digitalization of the wood supply chain and how we perceive the challenges and opportunities in this very exciting field. In the next couple of 20 minutes, I will kind of a little bit reflect on global drivers, digitalization pathway, how we kind of perceive it, and what are the kind of related challenges and opportunities, and then perhaps give some concluding remarks to fuel the discussion during the afternoon and evening that we are going to have together here. So starting basically from a global perspective at Pöyry, we always want to look at what is happening in the other kind of client space, which is of course in wide thinking kind of everybody using forest products, but then also more directly those who are basically producing these products to the markets. So basically in a big perspective, we are still living in a growing market. The wood utilization is growing in all product areas. We are estimating that by 2030, the wood demand in the world will grow by around 800 million cubic meters from today, which is about 15 times the annual harvest level in Finland. So we are talking about tremendous growth in industrial wood demand. The fastest growth we are seeing in construction and furniture end uses, which is basically relates to the solid wood and wood-based panel products. If you look at the global market, China and the Asian market is the growth engine of the forest product demand. Very fast growth of demand, at the same time very limited forest resources, meaning that we have to be able to serve the market from other platforms. And basically looking at the wood supply, we see growth in all the major producing regions around the globe. Now, the industry serving this growing market will require better forest data. It will require better forest systems to meet the growing demand. Looking a little bit more about the kind of forestry side of the equation, i.e. supply side, there is clear kind of distinction between what is happening in north and what is happening in southern hemisphere of the world. Plantation regions of south have been the fastest growing supply region already for some time. These regions are most competitive in producing kind of hardwood fiber, which is basically mostly pulp. For paper and paperboard products. Northern forests, including Scandinavia, plays a key role in producing high-quality softwood, which is mainly going to construction and uses, but also for high-quality paper and paperboard products. Now, if you look at the north versus south, the characteristics of the forests and forest operations are very different, and this relates also to the data needs. They differ greatly between the regions. In south, we talk about fast growth, MAIs of 30, 40, 50 cubes per hectare per year, rotations of 5 to 7 years in the best cases. In north, we talk about 70 plus years rotations, growth rates of 3 to 5 cubes per hectare per year. So completely different type of environments to manage and also plan from a data perspective. When coming a little bit closer to our home base, looking at the Baltic Sea region, I think we have two kind of key observations here. Firstly, actually Baltic Sea region is today one of the kind of investment hotspots when we look at the forest-based industry development, even in global perspective. There's a lot of investment in the industry, which is very much driven by the kind of strong industry fundamentals. We have a good investment environment. We have Chinese investors even in Finland looking at developing new projects. And this is then connected to the policy environment, which is very supportive. And when we talk about biofuels and bioenergy, the policies are of course key driver of renewable energy expansion that we have been seeing already for some times. At the same time, this region is also a leader in the forestry and wood supply chain digitalization. We can very proudly say that we definitely have the most advanced solutions here already developed, and this has been based on the longest track record of national forest inventories and forest data that we have in Finland and Sweden particularly. Nowhere else do we have so good forest resource data than in this region, at least in the northern part of the world. We have a long tradition of mechanization of the forest and wood supply chain, which of course provides a good opportunities for optimization along and throughout the supply chain. But even with these kind of fundamentals, we can still say that we are still at the very early stage of digitalization pathway. So how do we even see this, what we call a digitalization pathway? We perceive that there are kind of we can separate three distinctive waves, as we call them, in the digitalization. The first wave is about operational efficiency. It's about efficient utilization of operative data. It's about the continuous development of operations. It's about automation of processes. It's also about improved measurements, etc. One example that I could mention is just the measuring of the forest and standing trees, cell phone-based Trestima technology, which is a kind of innovation for making forest measurement more efficient than it was a few years ago. The second wave is about digitalization of interfaces. It's about improved client service through utilization of digital channels. It's about customized, more proactive client communication, which is facilitated by these new channels. Again, a good example that could be taken up is electronic wood trading, Qtio.fi in Finland, which is an electronic wood trading platform. Similar platform exists also in Sweden and actually also in some other parts of the world. The third wave is about new business models and digital disruptions. Completely new type of kind of business platforms and services that basically replace or distract actually the current kind of platforms and business models. Again, here we don't have yet too many examples, but perhaps one example to mention is from Sweden is the company called Lots Group, which is providing a holistic, comprehensive logistic and transport solution for the industries, which is also benefiting from digital platform and tools. What are then the kind of key drivers of innovation? We have been already talking about a digital revolution, which is happening as we speak. We have to understand, of course, that, and we know that this is connected to some other revolutions that we are having in our sector. It's a bioeconomy revolution that is also ongoing. It's about biotechnology revolution, which we are also living through. And this, of course, connects what Steve Jobs was basically perhaps already predicting 8 years ago that Rolf shared. That this may be one of the sectors where these new technologies and old traditions are meeting and perhaps collapsing in the most dynamic way at the moment. So what is this biotechnological revolution? It's about creating new bioproducts and biomaterials, which are already piloted and brought to the market, substituting old materials like plastics or substituting concrete or steel in constructions, etc. It's about kind of new cross-sectoral linkages where traditional forest industry and chemical industries need to perhaps work more together, or the traditional forest industry and construction sector need to work together in a new ways to kind of break down the inefficiencies in serving clients and making things more efficiently. And it's of course also about perhaps mitigating climate change more based on sustainable forestry and utilization of forest-based products. What is then, how do we perceive the digital forestry? This might be the kind of dream or vision that digital forestry could be. It's of course to having much more data and better data available for businesses. Using this data with integrated tools to really create new information, bringing the information layer to new level. And then using integrated tools and systems to use this information for more efficient management of people and operations, more efficient processes. This is the dream and vision that we all want to realize. And we are definitely walking towards that, but we are not yet still there. When we are working with our clients and also partners, we are still seeing a lot of challenges, which might be somehow correlating what I'm showing in this graph. We definitely have more data. As already indicated, 90% of all the data created in the world has been created during the last 2 years. So that's massive explosion of data, but we have big questions: is this qualitative improvement, and what of this tenfold amount of data is good data, useful data, and important data, and what's not? That's one of the challenges, and then we are still in the early stages of developing integrated tools to convert this data into information. In many cases, we have non-integrated tools, which ends up that we are using actually old information. Or in a worst case, even worse data and information that we had 2 days ago or 1 year ago. And when it comes to use this information, we don't always have best tools and systems to convert the information into efficient management of operations, processes, and people, which occasionally ends up that we have confused people and confused processes. So it's a little bit, of course, now a nightmare side of perhaps where we might be, but gives just a flavor of spectrum that we still have things to, I mean, way to go and definitely a lot of opportunities to go to the next level. we are kind of seeing the kind of three front lines in the development of digital forestry. The first front line relates to monitoring and control, and that's of course about using big data as an operative tool for increased accuracy and also increased responsiveness in operations, large scale or small scale operations. Responsiveness of course requires real-time data, and again when we have satellite technology also growing and expanding, the real-time data is getting better, more and more available. The second front line is about mechanization and automation. We have a huge opportunities for mechanization and robotics in field operations. We are already actually doing this, of course, if we talk about harvesters or cranes in trucks and unloading operations. Actually, they are already using a lot of kind of assistive or supportive robotic type of technologies to assist the operators in their day-to-day work. This automation has not yet fully replaced the operators, but it's assisting, and of course it's only a matter of time when we have a robotic harvesters in our forests, but that's not yet still today the fact of life. And of course we have a huge opportunity to use artificial intelligence in decision making and converting this big data into a meaningful information and decisions about what to do and what not to do. The third front line is about digital integration, and it's about how we can combine and connect market data to industries and to the forest resources, and vice versa, of course, the connectivity goes to the both directions. And even in forest, we can go to the tree level. Again, for example, Finland, we have already, our forest modeling is very much based on tree level models and applications. So this is very much real life in Finland. But still in Finland, we are not at the cell level, I think, and nowhere else either. So basically we have still kind of steps to take to really go to the micro level of the digital integration spectrum. Then one of the themes of the afternoon is climate change, just wanted to also kind of reflect that at Pöyry we are also very active in various initiatives related to the forests and climate change, and this is one development project where we are part of the consortium to develop a new kind of data platform. And it's about responding to the issue that current forest inventory data is still kind of too slow and unreliable to serve the kind of forest carbon market and carbon-related opportunities. And we are also lacking sufficient accounting systems for incentives or carbon credits. We have a multitude of standards and rules that are kind of making carbon market quite inefficient. So basically we are together with European Space Agency, are actually sponsored by European Space Agency, and together with European Forest Institute and VTT and Simosol put forces together and have a kind of vision and plan to develop an open and transparent and real-time based data platform about forest carbon data. And which can be of course when used for multitude of applications and for various end users, let them be forest and landowners or industry companies, transportation sector, funds and investors, etc., etc. So again, I mean, this relates to this digitalization topic, that we need better data, and the better data will enable completely new type of opportunities for us to succeed. So coming perhaps to the final step of my presentation, just wanted to share some reflections perhaps to fuel the discussions for our afternoon. I mean, basically, to start with, we see digitalization as a great enabler in bioeconomy and biotechnological revolution. A great opportunity, and it also will facilitate enhanced role of forests in mitigating climate change. Digitalization will also be a new competitive differentiator. Both actors who are fastest in covering the whole supply and value chain with kind of single point of truth are gonna be the winners in the market. And both actors who can really utilize the big data efficiently for analytics empowered by artificial intelligence will be the winners in the market. And what are the key things here is that we need to be able to seamlessly integrate kind of own data, proprietary data, and shared data and platforms. It's not only about owning data, it's also to be able to connect what data we have with what is available publicly and what could be actually developed from various sources and platforms. So we are still at a very early stage of the kind of digitalization pathway. The challenges are still very high, but the opportunities are even bigger. Thank you.